Good morning and welcome to worship on this first Sunday of February. You miss the music. You know how they finish playing something and then the worship leader can come up. But the worship leader has come up and she's going to invite Paul, who has a little message for us before we begin.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
I've been doing some work during the week and you may have noticed a little red wire on the floor. That's actually a temporary hearing aid loop. So it's not turned on at the moment. When I get back to the back, I'll turn it on. Hopefully, if it's not too loud for everyone. If anyone is too loud, it's for you. Just raise your hand if you've got a hearing aid and I'll adjust the volume for you. So that way, I don't want to make it worse by having it too loud. So that's all that loop will be under the floor eventually, so it'll be out of everyone's way. Thank you.
Saw you on telly.
You saw Paul on television?
Yeah.
Do tell. That has to come into notice, surely. The rest of us haven't been on telly, but here we go. Today, it's great to let you know that Jean is our preacher. It is so exciting as our own people here at Deception Bay Uniting Church use their talents to worship God. So today is Jean, and next week Pauline will be bringing us our message. This Friday coming sees the start of Helping Hands. It's been a bit of a rocky journey. We couldn't do anything in January, which people had asked us to do, but with COVID that wasn't possible. So we are meeting back on Friday afternoons now from 1 till 4 every second and fourth. Jude, that's right, isn't it?
Second and third.
No, second and fourth it has to be.
Oh, is it?
Yeah. We'll have it sorted out pretty soon, I reckon. The second and the fourth are Fridays of the month. It is COVID compliant, of course. And our first project, we're making quilts for Quilts of Valour. And they're the ones that go out to servicemen and women who are struggling with life's difficulties. And they have a little ceremony and the quilt is put around them just to let them know that others, apart from just themselves, are supporting them. And so it has helped a lot of people, and they believed it has stopped a lot of people from suiciding. So it's a really, really beautiful way to help others. So that's this Friday's. Just before Christmas, we saw Luke Howarth, our member, down at Woolies, and he let us know about a community grant. So we put in, because Helping Hands is our community activity. So we asked for batting and backing for quilts, but we were knocked back because what we were asking for, we give away. So we were off the list. We had to be keeping what we were asking for. So we were a little perplexed on that, but that was okay. And then on Tuesday, we were up at Warwick with our son, and in the middle of a paddock, the phone rang, and it was Luke Howarth's office, saying that the grants people would like us to resubmit something that we would be keeping. So I rang Judy, and from there we've got a quote, and what we were hoping to do is to line the end shed over there. That's where our quilts are kept until they're handed out to those that need them. Last year we did have the odd trouble with rats, I hate to admit. So we've got the quote, and we'd originally asked for $3,000, so that was the only amount we could ask for again, and the quote came in at just over tiny bit over $3,000. So that was wonderful. So in 2 to 3 weeks, I hope to be able to tell you whether or not we have been successful. So that was really lovely that they still really did want to do something to support Helping Hands, but it had to be, of course, under the criteria. Has anyone got any other notices they would like to share with us? No. Those of you with For Love to the World, I see Elaine had been busy handing them out, but as I haven't paid my $6 yet, I can't have mine. Today's psalm reading is the lectionary reading, and it is Psalm 138. I will praise you, O Lord, with all of my heart. Before other gods, I will sing your praise. I will bow down towards your holy temple and will praise your name. For your love and your faithfulness is exalted above all things. When I call you, you answer me. You make me bold and stout-hearted. May all the kings of the earth praise you, O Lord, when they hear the words of your mouth. May they sing of the ways of your glory. Though the Lord is on high, he looks on the lowly. But the proud he knows from afar. Though I walk in the midst of trouble, you preserve my life. You stretch out your hand against the anger of my foes, and your right hand saves me. The Lord will fulfill his purpose for me. Your love, O Lord, endures forever. Do not abandon the works of your hands. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, we gather this morning with those who love you, that we might sing your praises and share your love with one another. You have shown your faithfulness to us every day in ways we do not always recognize. So we gather today in order to thank you for your constant watch and care over us. Help us to entrust our lives to you, and to your purpose, as we pray in the name of Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us in the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. So just as the psalmist in Psalm 138 offered his praise to God, let us stand if we are able and sing the beautiful song, 10,000 Reasons for My Heart to Sing. Thanks, Cody.
The sun comes up.
In our prayer of confession. Dear Heavenly Father, we lower our heads before you and we confess that we have too often forgotten we are yours. Sometimes we carry on our lives as if there is no God and we fall short of being a credible witness to you. For these things we ask forgiveness and we also ask for strength. Give us clear minds and open hearts so we may witness to you in our world. Remind us to be who you would have us to be, regardless of what we are doing or who we are with. Hold us to you. Build our relationship with you and with those around us. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. The assurance. The love of Christ Jesus is patient and it's kind. His love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. His love will never end. So take heart, secure in the saving love of God, as I declare to you, your sins are forgiven, your guilt is wiped away, your hopes are restored. Thanks be to God. And now I invite you simply to listen to the next song. You've probably heard it. It's often on 96.5, for example, and it's the song, You Alone Can Rescue.
Shame was deeper.
And now we ask Jeff if he would come up and bring us our two Bible readings for this morning.
Today's first reading comes from the Old Testament, the book of Isaiah, chapter 6, verses 1 to 8. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord high and exalted, seated on a throne, and then the train of his robe filled the temple. Above him were seraphim, each with six wings. With two wings they covered their face, with two they covered their feet, and with two they were flying, and they were calling to one another, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty. The whole earth is full of his glory." At the sound of their voices, the doorposts and thresholds shook, and the temple was filled with smoke. "Woe to me," I cried. "I am ruined, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips. And my eyes have seen the King, the Lord Almighty." Then one of the seraphim flew to me with a live coal in his hand, which he had taken with tongs from the altar. With it he touched my mouth and said, "See, this has touched your lips. Your guilt is taken away and your sin atoned for." Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, "Whom shall I send? And who will go for us?" And I said, "Here I am, Lord, send me." The second reading is from the first book of Corinthians, chapter 15, verses 1 to 11. And it's Paul telling the story of the resurrection to his brothers and sisters. "Now, brothers and sisters, I want to remind you of the gospel I preached to you, which you received, and on which you have taken your stand. By this gospel you are saved, if you hold firmly to the word I preached to you. Otherwise you have believed in vain. For what I received I pass on to you as of first importance, that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, that he was buried, and then he was raised on the third day according to the scriptures, and he appeared to Cephas, and then to the 12. After that, he appeared to more than 500 of our brothers and sisters at the same time, most of whom are still living, though some have fallen asleep. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles, and last of all, he appeared to me also, as to one abnormally born. For I am the least of the apostles and do not even deserve to be called an apostle because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace to me was not without effect. No, I worked harder than all of them, yet not I, but the grace of God that was with me. Whether then it is I or they, this is what we preach, and this is what you believe. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. So, how did you first come to know Jesus? This was the direct and somewhat startling question I was asked by a uniting minister some years ago. We had just moved into a little rental house in Wood End in Victoria after some 10 years overseas. And the minister had come to welcome us to the area, but he didn't engage in much small talk. He went straight to the point. And I was catapulted back to my early experiences of faith. As a small child, I lived in a village in England,
And I went along to the local Sunday school and Good News Club, which was held in the little chapel just across the road from home. And we were taught the importance of asking Jesus into our hearts. And we were really encouraged to pinpoint the exact moment when we became a Christian. We even sang a song about it. And don't worry, because I'm not going to sing it to you today. But I want you to imagine a room full of noisy Yorkshire children, all singing lustily, "Happy birthday to you. Only one will not do. Born again in salvation, happy birthday to you." So that was some of my first experiences of faith. This morning we are going to focus our thoughts on Paul's first letter to the Corinthians, chapter 15. Writing to the Christians at Corinth, Paul speaks of the moment when the risen Christ appeared to him, and his life was never the same again. The wonder of this salvation never left Paul, and it sustained him through a life which had more than its share of hardships, shipwrecks, beatings, imprisonment, and finally the road to martyrdom. Now, I suspect that many of us have come to Christ in a much more gradual way. In fact, some of us probably can't even remember a time when we didn't believe. We are mesmerized when we read about Paul's dramatic conversion on the road to Damascus. And sometimes we hear testimonies of former drug addicts and criminals who have also had a dramatic conversion. And we can think that our own experiences are pretty boring and humdrum. But the truth is that each of us has a beautiful story. So let me encourage you to spend some time today to be quiet and just think about how God has drawn you to himself, and never lose hold of the wonder of it. And last week, as I listened to Glenn's sermon, I realized that he'd drawn out they're very similar thoughts from a different part of the New Testament. Do you remember how he spoke to us about owning our own story and connecting with other people so that we can find a way of telling them about God? So what do you think? Is God trying to tell us something here? I wonder if you have heard of the famous poet Francis Thompson. He was born in the north of England in 1859, and as a young man, he was forced to study medicine in the hope that he was following his father's footsteps. But he had always dreamed of becoming a writer, and so before long, he ran away to London, and then his life took a turn for the worst. He became very, very sick, and finally addicted to drugs. And in despair and destitution, he lived with the homeless in London on the banks of the River Thames, and he had to sell those little boxes of matches just to stay alive. And it was right at this low point of his life, dominated by hunger and hopelessness, that he found his Heavenly Father. Or as he more correctly expressed it himself, his Heavenly Father found him. In 1890, he wrote an engaging poem called The Hound of Heaven. We don't tend to use the word hound much in everyday speech, but it's just a dog who's usually very good at running and loves to be involved in a chase or a hunt. And the poet uses the hound to symbolize the love of God, pursuing his soul until he surrenders to it. Initially, he tries to run away from this love and to find his delights in all kind of earthly pleasures. He is fearful that if he surrenders to God, he will lose everything else. Let's hear just the beginning of the poem. I've adapted some of the archaic language to make it a bit easier to understand. But I want us to be caught up in the cadence, the rhythm of the words, because it captures beautifully the sense of the relentless yet loving God as he seeks to capture our hearts and draw us to himself. I fled him down the nights and down the days. I fled him down the arches of the years. I fled him down the twisted corridors of my own mind. And in the midst of tears, I hid from him and under running laughter, from those strong feet that followed after. No matter what our background, no matter what has kept us from God in the past, we can be absolutely certain that he has searched for us too, unceasingly pursued us, and finally captured us in his firm yet loving arms. In the opening verses of chapter 15, Paul outlines what he sees as the essential truths of the gospel. Paul wants to make it quite clear that this wasn't a gospel he just conjured up. It was what he had received from the apostles who had been eyewitnesses to these events. And he uses the technical terms for reception and transmission. For I received what I delivered to you. And it is quite likely that he is here repeating words that had already put into a formula that was easy to remember and recite. This was the usual practice in an oral culture, because of course they didn't have a written copy of the Gospels to rely on. So here is the formula. Christ died for our sins according to the scripture. He was buried. He was raised again on the third day according to the scripture. And Paul continues later in chapter 15 to stress the importance and centrality of the resurrection. And at times we need to go back to the simplicity of these essential truths of our faith. When we are attempting to witness to what we believe, we need to remember that these are the simple yet profound truths that are the amazing gifts we have to pass on. Now, it might help to think about preparing a gift to give to a loved one at Christmas or a birthday. Now, I'm pretty hopeless at wrapping up presents. Whatever I do, it always ends up looking really messy, and I get all caught up in the sticky tape which goes back onto itself. So I don't find it a very easy job. But one thing I do try to get right is to find a wrapping paper that matches the person I'm going to give the present to. So I might choose something with teddy bears for a baby, and for a younger child, maybe, some Disney characters, and then for a lady, maybe some beautiful flowers. And then for a man, well, it's always difficult to know what to do for a man, isn't it? But maybe choose a suitable colour, perhaps a picture of some cars or something like that. And in the same way, we may wrap up the gift of the gospel that we want to pass on in new and enticing ways to encourage people to take a look. But it is essential that the central truths of our message remain the same. You see, the important thing is never the wrapping, it is always the gift. Paul says to the Corinthian Christians in verse 2, that this is the gospel that they have received and on which they have taken a stand. And we too are called to take a stand. In a slippery world, it keeps us on our feet. In a tempting world, it gives us the power to resist. In a hurting world, it enables us to endure heartbreak or physical suffering and not give in. Paul encourages the readers to hold firmly to the word. We too need to hold to the faith tenaciously. It's a lovely word, isn't it? Tenaciously. It just means firmly. The great Scottish commentator on the New Testament, William Barclay, says this: life makes many attempts to take away our faith. Things happen to us and to others which baffle our understanding. Life has problems to which there seem to be no solutions, and to questions that seem to have no answers. Life has its dark places where there seems to be nothing to do but to hold on. Faith is always the victory of the soul which tenaciously maintains a tight grip on God. Paul says later in verse 2 that it is through this gospel that they have been saved. Now, the English translation here doesn't quite do justice to Paul's thoughts. In the original Greek, the word saved is in the present tense. So instead of "it is through the gospel that you have been saved," it should really read, "it is through the gospel that you are being saved." Now, I know I might sound like an awful old school mom pointing out the tenses of the verb, but it does make an important difference. You see, what he is saying is that our salvation isn't just a single event, a kind of a one-off that happened to us long ago, but it is something that continues to unfold in our lives. Something we will never exhaust in our lifetime. There will always be more to learn, more to celebrate, and more to do. And this is sometimes where the crunch comes. Just as in The Hound of Heaven, the writer did his best to flee from the loving God who was pursuing him, we can also try to run away from what God is asking us to do next. Those of you who use our lovely devotional book, Love to the World, may remember the story of the call of Jeremiah and the comments by the Reverend Robert McFarlane. This was back on the 24th of January. He made the interesting claim that the Bible is a book full of excuses. And he gives a few examples. So when God called Jeremiah, he said, "Oh no, I'm too young." And at the other end of the scale, when he told Abraham and Sarah they were going to be the parents of a great nation, they said, "Oh no, we're too old." And when God called Moses, he said, "I'm not really a good speaker." And of course, in the lovely Old Testament reading that Jeff read for us, when God called Isaiah, he said he was unclean. But God, in his endless mercy and with his unfailing sense of humour, managed to find an answer to all their excuses. The young Jeremiah was given strength for his prophetic work. Abraham and Sarah were given a miracle. Moses was allowed to work alongside Aaron. And Isaiah was cleansed by the burning coal. And so he was able to say, "Here am I, send me." And this is the response God wants from all of us. Here am I, send me. Unfortunately, we are often tempted to say, here am I, would you mind sending someone else? And the writer in Love to the World suggested that we write down a list of all our reasons for not doing something new for God and then burn it. So that's a challenge. I must admit I haven't done that yet. Soon after we were married, Keith and I felt the call of God to go to the small African kingdom of Lesotho. At the time, it was one of the poorest countries in the world and had few of the comforts that we all enjoy in Australia today. So I want you to try and imagine what it was like for us. The university where Keith was teaching was in a village with the surprising name of Roma. And you can see a picture of the Roma Valley here. To reach the capital city, if we wanted to do some shopping, we had to drive along a winding dirt road. And we needed to remember to be careful when we came to a corner, because there may have been some donkeys meandering across just as we turned. Now, in the capital city, there were a few shops, but not really as many as we have in our marketplace here in Deception Bay. So not a huge shopping centre. So life was pretty basic. And there was no TV, of course, but we did have a radio. And one of our funniest memories was turning on our radio at night to listen to the news. So we heard the dramatic musical introduction and an enthusiastic voice saying, "This is Radio Lesotho. Here is the news." And then there was a pause. And then a quieter voice said, "There is no news." So we looked at each other and said, "Oh, well, nothing's happened today." Can you imagine that happening to in Channel 9 or Channel 7? They just make up something, don't they, and pad it all out. While we were in Lesotho, we had the opportunity to educate the students and connect with those of people of faith who would go on to be leaders in their country. And we were soon captivated by the haunting beauty of the Roma Valley, set in the foothills of the Drakensberg Ranges. And what a joy it was to know the people. They had such pride in their culture and heritage and lived with such contentment in difficult circumstances. Now, we must have been living in Lesotho for about a year when one night I was lying in bed thinking how blessed we were to live in such a beautiful place. I suddenly had a flashback to my childhood. I think I must have been a really strange little girl. For when I'd been a Christian for a few years, I had the thought, what happens if God wants me to be a missionary in Africa? And I was absolutely horrified by this possibility. So I had a talk to God about it. I wanted to make it quite clear that I didn't want to be that kind of Christian. I didn't want to go to faraway places and to do difficult things. All I wanted was to live a quiet life. I was prepared to go to church on Sunday, that was okay. But I just wanted to be a normal Christian. Well, guess what? There's no such thing as a normal Christian. All of us are called to serve God in different ways, and we will all constantly be challenged to move beyond what we think is normal. And when we respond to his call, our gracious God will find a way of encircling what we have been fearful about with his own special joy. So I would like to encourage all of us not to be afraid of what God wants us to do. Think back on your own lives. I'm sure you've all had that experience in one form or another. Now, I think that for the foreseeable future, most of us will be called to serve God in Deception Bay and through this precious little church. And how this calling will be worked through is a question that we have to consider prayerfully together. So let's have a quick recap of what we have gleaned from Paul's letter to the Corinthians today. Firstly, let us never lose sight of the wonder of our salvation. Whether we came to know God gradually, or whether we know the exact moment when we became a Christian, let us always remember that something absolutely remarkable has happened. We have been pursued and our hearts have been captured by the eternal and ever-loving God. Secondly, let us never forget that we are being saved. This salvation is still being worked out in our lives in a beautiful and dynamic way. Whatever our age, God still has more to do in us. As the old cliche goes, we are all still a work in progress. Thirdly, let us always hold fast to the central truths of our faith. Christ died for our sins, was buried, and was raised to life on the third day. However much we may enjoy debating the more complex and sensitive questions that sit around the edges of these truths, however much we want to wrap up the faith so that we can engage with people in our rapidly changing world, the centre remains the same. And as we think of the prophet Isaiah and his vision of the magnificent Lord in heaven, where may we all be brave enough to say, "Here am I, send me." The Apostle Paul made no excuses. Listen again to his words from verse 9, which contain both a challenge and a comfort for us. "For I am the least of the apostles, and do not even deserve to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace to me was not without effect. No, I worked harder than all of them, yet not I, but the grace of God that was with me." Let us pray. Thank you, Lord, for this special place and this special group of people whom you cherish. We praise you that you have lovingly pursued us and drawn us to yourself. May we listen humbly to the Spirit teaching us what you want us to do next. Give us confidence to share our stories with each other and to always be sensitive to your call to serve our community. Amen. And now, because we've been thinking about the resurrection, we're going to join together in that beautiful hymn, "Thine Be the Glory, Risen Conquering Son." Shall we stand to sing?
Rain, roll the stone away.
Please be seated. And now we'll take the time to pray for others. Father God, you sent Jesus to help mend that which is broken. And so today we pray for relationships destroyed by actions and words, relationships worldwide between countries, relationships between families, relationships between friends. Lord, you alone can help in these situations. We remember Afghanistan and the traumas there, and especially we pray for those trying to earn a living for their families, for the women who once glimpsed what they could achieve, and now this has been taken away. We pray earnestly for the situation between Ukraine and Russia. The relationships there have never been easy. In Ukraine, so much wickedness was perpetrated by Russia after the Second World War, so uneasy relationships have existed ever since. And now, Father God, we ask that diplomacy and a regard for peace will prevail. As school returns, we pray for our teachers, our students, our admin staff, our chaplains, and all others involved in the life of our schools. We ask that harmony and understanding may prevail so that all may learn to their maximum potential. We pray for our world still dealing with COVID and its aftermath, the economic breakdowns, the relationships in disturbances as people haven't been able to meet with each other, and we pray for restoration. For the folk in nursing homes especially, those who cannot understand the whys and wherefores of change. Lord, be with them. May there come a time soon when our church will be able to again minister to our folk in Seabrook, who are longing to worship together, to sing and pray together. We pray for the ill of mind and body, those facing surgery. Be with them and their families as they work through these hard times together. And finally today, we pray for the wider church and for us here at Deception Bay. Be with us as we seek our path forward. Be with us as our folk can come together again after the effect of COVID lessons. Be with us as we pray earnestly for wisdom, for grace, and for God's love to guide us in all our actions. In each of our lives, Lord, be glorified. Amen. And please remain seated as we sing, "I Give You My Heart," as the offering is taken up for the work of the church here and further away. Thank you for your faithfulness. We thank you that we can always trust in you. We give you this offering today, and with it we worship you and give you our whole selves. Please now use it for your kingdom and for your glory. Extend its reach so it may be a blessing to others. Amen. And now would you like to rise for the benediction? As you go this day, go out to serve Christ without undue pride or anxiety. Do whatever you can to help others. Entrust to others the things that you should, and above all, dedicate your success and your failures to the glory of God. And may the grace of Christ, the love of God the Father, and the constant encouragement of the Holy Spirit be with you now and in the future. Amen. And our final song is one that we've already heard the words of from Isaiah, and we'll sing, "Here I Am, Lord."
I made the stars of night. I
come and share your life stories over tea and coffee.